stop being a con man?
Do you ever stop being a cop? You know, I was never particularly fond of cops.
I was more comfortable when he was a crook.
I saw that two-hour television movie you did last year. Very demanding role. You're a very good actress, Lynn. May I have the envelope, please?
It's short. $1,000.
How's a poor chap like me to know whether you're acting or whether you're not? You really have magnificent hair. There isn't a split end in sight. No bleaching, no dyeing, no frizz treatments. Of course, I know you're magnificent.
Don't I? From pictures. The dirty ones.
I don't know what you put in my drink at that reception or how you got it there. But I don't go any place unescorted anymore except maybe church. And I seriously doubt you'd try to drug me there.
I don't like late payments. I don't like partial payments. I won't tolerate them.
You're despicable.
That, my dear, will cost you.
If you just told me these two were the same man, I'd never believe you.
He came to Hollywood from New York in 1966. He had a shot at success in 1970 when he made a pilot for a proposed TV series called Durango. Did you ever hear of that one?
No.
The pilot sold, but Mr. Kirk was so hard to get along with, the network replaced him with someone else.
I thought a lot about what you said yesterday. And maybe my only option is to go to the police. As long as he has those pictures, I'm always going to be dangling at the end of his line.
I thought a good deal about your problem myself last night. I used to be with the police. They're trustworthy, but bureaucratic. Things get lost. They get misplaced. Let's face it, your pictures could get out.
Mr. McBride, I am a very private person. I guess you might say my values are old-fashioned, but I don't think I could handle it if any of those pictures were made public.
Have you ever seen any of these photographs?
Yes, I don't know what he drugged me with, probably some kind of hallucinogenic. But I look like I was having the time of my life.
What we've got here is an actor who is a bitter, frustrated man. He stages his own production every time he wants you to make a payment. He must have a monstrous ego.
That could be our key.
It's his ego that makes him monstrous. How can that be of any help?
Well, if we feed his ego in just the right way, we might just get some of those pictures back.
First, we have to make you look like a producer. If you look like a producer, you are a producer.
How much is this going to cost me?
$350.
Come on, I'll wear my old suit. That's ridiculous.
You're paying for the label.
I'm going to wear it inside out?
J'ai apporté ça l'envers.
I think it looks great on you, Mac. Really. And it fits beautiful.
It's an intriguing blend of Hollywood and the Eastern panache that you're striving for, Pete. It brings to mind Princeton, Harvard, old money.
Well, it may be old money, but it's my money. $350,
I'm under tremendous pressure. I have Sammy Davis coming in at 11, and I have 1 million things to do.
Look at it this way, Mac. It may be $350, but it's the cheapest jacket in the store, and it looks great on you.
Well, all right. That's the way it is. That's the way it is.
Now, how about your shoes?
I've worn them for years. Fit well, serviceable. Very nice. Soft as a baby's bottom. And $73.50.
Producers spend more time choosing shoes than they do scripts.
Don't be offended, Mr. McBride, but you look just like a cop on the take.
Speaking of the take, where did you get this coach in six? I'm not riding around in a hot car.
What hot? It's air conditioned. It's a joke, Mr. McBride. It's a loaner.
Does the guy who loaned it know about it?
Yeah, it's a friend of Pete's. Right, Pete?
He's away on business, upstate. He'll be gone a long time.
Like 5 to 8 years. This is bulletproof glass. What kind of a business is your friend into?
Let's go.
Now we gotta figure out how to get an office at a major studio.
Yeah, I think I've got that worked out.
Mr. Brewster?
Fred Brewster. It was about the Detroit co-production deal. He said it was all set up.
Co-production? Mr. Brewster? Co-production? Somehow your appointment didn't get written down. My regular secretary is out having a baby, and Enid is temporary. Anyway, refresh my memory on the deal. What was it you needed for me?
He arranged with us office space for our company, Counterpoint Productions from Detroit. Now, I know that Mr. McBride talked to Mr. Brewster.
Yes, I'm sure he did. I just, I don't know.
Oh. Wait. It could be that the fault is on our side. We were trying for anonymity for our production. You know, when a major automobile concern from Detroit decides to finance motion pictures as a part of their leisure industries, well, it's very important that our first efforts are successful. No, can't sort of patch together with hand-me-downs, hence the reason for the low profile before we start rolling.
Detroit? You mean Ford or GM or...
Wait. You see what you're doing right now? That's exactly what Freddie told Mr. McBride wouldn't happen. I can understand your curiosity. Naturally, you'll have to know who we are when we make our big move, but right now we're just here for a few days looking around.
And Mr. McBride is connected with Counterpoint Productions.
Oh, yes.
And he also likes to keep a very low profile.
Uh-oh. Oh, my.
Look at this. He's not able to keep a very low profile because he's having a set to with the guard at the gate.
It's the parking again.
I'm sure it is some screw-up, Mr. McBride, but we have our rules. Now, unless you have a pass, I can't let you on the lot.
A couple of weeks on the chassis assembly line, it'd straighten you out, my friend.
Yeah, it seems there was a mix-up. Now, if you'll just pull your car right over there.
Mr. McBride, this is Len Eckhart. Len is in charge of studio facilities.
Oh, you must be the one I talked to on the phone, eh?
Sorry about the parking pass, Mr. McBride. Things got a little bollocked up.
No problem, no problem. All right, where do we bunk in?
Oh, there's been a little mix-up on that matter, too, Mr. McBride. It seems that they don't have any office space in their new building or any of their buildings. I think it might be wise for you to pop up and see Mr. Fred Brewster. He firmed the deal up.
Why don't I just shoot up and talk to old Fred?
Mr. Brewster's now winging his way to Russia with several stops in between. It would be very difficult to contact him.
It's a pity.
What you said upstairs, you're sure you won't be here longer than a few days?
Certainly not. Why do you ask?
Well, there is a temporarily vacant suite on the 11th floor. If you'll come back at 2...
Come back at 2? What time do you have, Mr. Ryan?
10:12.
You?
10:11.
It's exactly 10:12 on the dot. Mr. Eckhart, we can make an entire automobile in 7.3 minutes. By 2 o'clock this afternoon, Mr. Eckhart, 600 Pinto hatchbacks will have rolled off the Flint assembly line, and by 2 o'clock, you will have opened one office door?
Right this way.
I think I'm going to like it here.
Well, I wouldn't get too used to it, Mac. We're only going to be here for a week, if that long.
You worried about Eckhart?
Yes, I am. He's married to this company. They're the worst kind of con. Now, he may be nervous, but he's loyal.
Now, how do I look, huh?
Great.
Yeah? What was it Sam Goldwyn used to say? A rock's a rock, a tree's a tree. Shoot it in Griffith Park, we don't shoot at all. Grand old man.
Hello.
Thank you, Mrs. Siri. I remember you.
No, martini for me.
Huh? Oh, well, I pulled out of it, you know.
Yes, thank you.
Who can put up with all that weekly grind?
It's a lively place you got here, huh?
You know, I'm expecting Jimmy Kahn in by the end of the week. Yeah, I talked to his agent briefly on the phone.
Oh, has Jimmy read the script yet?
Agent says he's very high on it. But you know, I can't help thinking how we do these things back home in Detroit. We weren't satisfied with those same old models every year, all those variations. This public still got bored. If I had my druthers, I'd rather start this picture with all new faces.
One of them.
Bring your drink, Lucius, and pull.
He had something to do with pollution or something.
You a betting man?
I'm betting that Mules
will be a bigger hit than The Godfather.
Well, you're making a good point. It's got a good script, good pace, and a new slant on the international cocaine smuggling.
You know, I knew a guy like that once.
He was in America, in Mexico. He's a student.
Huh?
He's doing time now. Claims he wasn't even carrying this stuff. Anyway, with James Caan in the picture, you gotta be laughing all the way to the bank.
Oh, he's a great performer, no question. But you know how old Frank McBride got his reputation back in Detroit? Seat of the pants flying. That's why I'd like to start this picture with a whole new line of stars of the future.
Excuse me. You know, I've played this table many times, and there's a way you can make that shot now. You put a lot of top English.
My friend, did I ask you for any pointers on how to play this game? I was making these shots when you were knee-high to a pool cue, and I never used top English. Now bugger off.
questions? Yeah, why don't you come by the office in the morning? We'll talk about your client's screen test.
Mr. McBride, listen, I just...
Oh, here you are, yeah. Black Mercedes, wake up the chauffeur.
No, I'm not the parking attendant. I'm the guy that teed you off the pool table. Look, I just want to apologize for butting in.
Please, the Black Mercedes, wake up the chauffeur.
Eldorado. Brian? Look, excuse me. I couldn't help but overhear what you were talking about at the pool table, and I thought maybe I could help you out. See, I used to be with the Border Patrol a few years back, and I know all about what you're into on your picture.
We've already got our technical consultant. In fact, we got three of them, actually. Thank you very much.
The name's Anthony Kirk, and actually, what I am is an actor.
Come on. Oh, well, in that case, you ought to know Pete Ryan. He's what's that fancy name you call yourself? He's an artiste's representative.
Oh, an agent.
Yeah, good luck on the Border Patrol.
Mr. McBride, look, I'll tell you, I haven't been with the Border Patrol for quite a few years.
Yeah?
Look, I'm gonna lay it on the line. I know you're casting for a picture. I think I'd be doing myself a disservice if I didn't come out here, meet you, and tell you I'm available.
You just took me back? I don't know how many years. I was just a kid. I was 25, working. I saw Mr. Ford come out of the plant one evening. Mr. Henry Ford, man I... No, just a minute, please. Man I admired. A month before he died, it was. And I walked up to him. I was very shy, but on this impulse, I walked up. I says, Mr. Please, please. I walked up to him, and I says, Mr. Ford, I want to shake your hand.
It's getting late. Well, let's get
don't
going.
You know he was touched? Took my name, went on to... I don't have... 10:30 tomorrow, my office, United International Studios.
Nice meeting you.
Mr. Kirk.
Great.
Mr. Ryan?
See ya.
Right. You'd make a great agent.
You'd make a great producer.
Henry Ford?
Mr. McBride, I can't even find the main gate.
Keep trying.
Hello, yes, could you give me the extension for the main gate, please?
I'm Anthony Kirk.
Hi, I was just calling the main gate to get a pass for you.
Hello. I haven't needed a pass at a major studio in over 4 years.
Oh.
I've got a 10:30 appointment with Mr. McBride.
Yes, you sure do. Mr. McBride, Mr. Kirk is here to see you.
Ask him to wait.
Yes, sir. Mr. Kirk, Mr. McBride asks if you would just wait a moment.
Hello. Yeah, how are things going?
Kirk sure has some apartment. He lives high on the hog. He's got enough X-rated stuff here to supply the Danish pornography fair.
Did you find the pictures of Lane?
Yeah, but just the prints, no negatives. Our boy is a busy little blackmailer and no penny-ante one either.
Lane is only one of many. There's dozens in his files. Malcolm put it the best. He's a sicko.
It should just be a few more minutes. Can I get you some more coffee?
Love, if I have any more coffee, I'm going to have to call Roto-Rooter to fix my plumbing. The name is Kirk.
Oh, the picture. That's not set yet, but it looks like it's going to be James Caan and Lane Cameron. Oh, I should say she is, yeah. And when will you meet her in person?
That Lane Cameron's quite a good little actress.
Did I hear right? Is she going to play the part in the picture?
Yeah, it looks that way.
Come in!
At last, I can't believe it.
Thanks for seeing me, Mr. McBride. I don't want to take up too much of your time.
Oh, that's a funny thing. Last night you looked much younger.
Oh, well, I can go a lot younger. I photograph, depending on the lights, 23, 24 years old.
Uh-huh. Well, let's see. Now, we were talking about the caddy part, weren't we? The caddy, yeah. What kind of a car do you drive? Oh, the Eldorado. That's right. Tell me, you got any problems with that one?
No. Just the regular servicing.
Now, in terms of my dramatic training, I studied in New York with Leo Litvick.
Buongiorno.
Don't buongiorno me. There's a disquieting rumor going around that your client doesn't want to test
for this
role.
It is more than a rumor. I'm afraid Lane's days of testing are over.
All right, hold it. We'll go around on that afterward. Right now, I want to plow into some of the casting problems with these minor players. Oh, here, you remember Mr. The pool kibitzer, sir, from last night.
Tennis elbow. Good to see you. You play?
Yeah, I play a little tennis.
All right, already. He plays tennis. Sit down, will you? Rest your elbow. You were telling me about your study in New York with this Russian fellow. Go ahead.
No, he was Lithuanian. And he was the greatest acting teacher in this century.
You speak any Spanish?
I speak five languages.
Well, that's very nice, as long as one of them is Spanish, because the caddy's got a couple of lines in Spanish.
What about the rest of his lines?
Rest of his lines, he's got one in English. Well, English, he's got a kind of an accent, you know. He says, here are your cleats, senor. You got an ear for accent? Did Litvak cover that?
Have you ever heard of The Tempest?
What?
You probably think I'm talking about a two-door sedan put out by Pontiac. Now, wait a minute, I'm talking about Shakespeare, Mr. McBride, the man. I played Caliban for Joe Papp in Central Park. Joe Papp hugged me when it was over.
Hugged you?
I also played Jamie in Long Day's Journey, and the night I had people rushing off their seats. Now, I could go on about this, but all I'm going to do is tell you I don't play caddy parts or bit parts or walk-ons. Now, last night, you were making very big noises about finding new talent. Well, go ahead. Discover away.
I like spunk. I mean, I really do. I mean, spunk built Detroit. Hey, Pete, how do you think Miss Lane would feel about working with Tony here?
You mean you want him to play the lead? Wayne Franks? No, I mean, you must have been fantastic in The Tempest, but that's out of the question.
I'm talking about the test. He would pinch hit for Jimmy Kahn.
You see, she doesn't want a test to begin with, and I'm not going to put her in there with an unknown. I'm not going to accept that under any circumstances whatsoever.
Look, Mr., I don't want to waste your time anymore, but consider the test yours. No, we'll iron everything out. Don't worry about that. Now, let me tell you something. If you give me in that test what you just gave me in here, we'll beef up that caddy part. See, any reason that the caddy couldn't announce the church is burning? There you are. Yeah, give me that line. The church is burning. Let me hear you.
You haven't listened to a word I've said.
Holy Toledo.
What happened to him? He is really swearing at you.
I think we pushed it way, way too far, man.
Yeah, you're right. I overdid it a little bit there.
Hello?
Miss Lane Cameron? This is your Acme Blackmail Agency here.
What do you want?
What do I want? You owe me a big Solomon P. Chase. That's what I want, and I want it tonight.
I can't get the money on that short notice, and besides, I have to appear on a telethon tonight.
Well, you're just gonna have to get the money, and you're just gonna have to tell them little cripple kiddies to take a rain check. Don't forget the interest. Same place, same time.
I was listening on the extension.
Now what? I didn't think I'd have to go through that again. What are you people doing anyway? Aren't I paying you enough money? I'm sorry. Well, I suppose I can borrow the money. Bloodsucker.
You've never been in a con before, Lane. But there's a moment at the end when the mark knows he's been had and the bottom starts to fall out. Well, there's no other feeling like that in the whole world. So, just hang on, huh? Revenge is gonna be sweet.
Smell the eucalyptus. May I have the envelope, please?
It's all there, plus your interest.
Oh, don't toddle off so fast. I mean, you have no idea how I look forward to these little chats. They buck me up when I'm feeling low, and you're gonna buck me up tonight, aren't you?
No.
Not yet, love. Not so far.
What is that right up to?
Now, you just come along with me. Come on. Come with me.
No!
Everybody, put your all the people to you.
Even if you did get him back on the track, I don't... After tonight, I don't think I could go through with that screen test.
Look, there's no question about it. It's going to be the biggest acting job of your career. Look, the decision's up to you.
Mr. McBride's secretary. Thank God I got hold of you. I have been trying to reach you all day yesterday and last night.
Bugger off.
Oh, please, you don't understand. You see, I'm in very hot water. See, I held up a call from James Kahn's agent, and that's why the screen test got all fouled up. Mr. McBride just tore my head off. Tony, Mr. McBride was really impressed by you, and I put in my 2 cents worth. I really gave you a big buildup.
This test, it's with Lane Cameron, right?
Yeah, 11 o'clock today.
Yeah, okay. I'll tell you, I'll do it. But I'm only doing it to keep you off the hook.
Nice going, Maggie.
Cameron.
Hi. It's going to be nice working with you. What do you prefer, Anthony or Tony?
What time did you tell the crew to get her? They got to set up the equipment.
The equipment's here.
Huh?
So is the crew.
Good morning.
Lane, now this is not only going to be your test, but we're going to be testing some equipment here. See these trucks? You know Mr. McBride.
Hi, Mr. McBride. Good to see you.
We've got hidden cameras in these trucks so they can use these out on the public streets and shoot without attracting crowds.
Oh, yes. I've worked that way before. Now, where will the director be?
Oh, I'll be inside the van there, in the back there.
You?
Yes, using directional mics.
You are going to direct the test?
Of course.
We have directorial approval. You see, I'm not going to put Lane in that kind of a situation to have somebody like you direct.
I beg your pardon. You had directorial approval over the film, not the test. Now, may I have your scripts? Let's get on with this. Thank you. Mick, ready for the action. I'll give you action.
Got you. You all right, Lane?
I'm fine.
Don't let her down, kid.
No problem.
Stand by. All right, action.
This is insane. They shoot this way all the time.
With real microphones. I wouldn't even know when they're through with the scene.
Yes, you will. You will. Because Lane's going to take her scarf off.
Her scarf?
You think he liked it?
Dynamite! Dynamite! That operator come running out of the projection room where he's been sitting for the last
60 years, and he's, and I quote, he says, who is that young fireball up there on the screen? Fireball! Oh, there's a bad side, yeah. My people back in Detroit, they had their hearts set on Jimmy Kahn, but I convinced them otherwise. But they'll be gunning for you. I don't want you to worry. I can handle those grease monkeys.
Now, wait a minute. Are you saying you want me to play the part of Wayne Franks?
What do you think we've been talking about for the last 5 minutes? You make a bigger impact on the world than Jack Nicholson and Volkswagen put together. What's going on here? What do we need there, a revolving door? Oh, look, I can't stay mad. I am riding a blockbuster. I hate to admit this because it might interfere with the contractual negotiations, but you're
fine. I have to stop you.
Huh?
There aren't going to be any contractual negotiations.
Oh, hey, always clowning.
I'm not clowning. You see, Lane, she's not going to do the movie.
Well, what's the problem? Is it me? I mean, she seemed all fired up.
It's a personal problem, you see? And the bottom line is, she's not going to be in the picture.
Are you putting us on?
I am not putting you on.
Let me tell you, Pete, if you are on the level, if you pull Lane Cameron out of this picture, I lose my Detroit money, and I am going to sue you right down to your shoelaces.
I'd like to speak to Mr. McBride privately.
Sorry, Tony.
Boy, oh boy, if we ran Detroit like they run this loony bin, we'd be given rebates on horses.
Maybe it's none of my business, but Lane's good. I mean, hell, she's terrific, but she's not the only actress in the Players directory.
No, it's got nothing whatever to do with it. That's the trouble. The Detroit money loves her. I couldn't replace her. No way.
Now, that's it, huh?
No, not at all. I wouldn't say that. I like you. We'll work together. It's in the cards.
Now you just hold on a minute. You know something? A few seconds ago, I was writing Hallie's comment on back in the toilet. I don't think it's asking too much for some kind of an explanation. Tony!
Do yourself a big favor. Don't probe this. It's a private matter. Walk away from it.
Hi, Tony. What do you say?
Come on in.
Thank you.
Would you like a drink?
Why not? Okay, you can hold it right there. You know what I'd like to do? I'd like to stick this gun in your mouth and pull the trigger till the hammer wears down.
I don't know what happened, but why don't you put the gun away and we can talk it over?
You've been on my back all along. You act like an honorable man, but you're just like all the rest. Capatri, tell me something. How do you feel right now in your gut? Feel like you drank some of your own dirty water? Hey, that's a scene from The Mule. Don't you recognize it? You remember where Wayne confronts Raoul and repays him from blowing up the church? Can I act or can I act?
You can act. Whoever said you couldn't?
Well, you did, for one. You think I'm a nobody. You turned Lane against me, right?
No.
Hey, what are you talking about, Kirk? You're out to lunch.
This has nothing to do with me versus you. Look, I don't owe you this, but this is a personal thing with Lane. It has nothing to do with the movie or you or anything like that. It's an entirely different kind of situation.
Listen, man, this was my big chance. I've been waiting all my life for this thing.
I think he deserves an explanation.
This is nothing personal. You seem like a very decent guy, but Lane, one slip of the tongue and this could hit the papers.
I don't think Tony is that kind of...
I'm advising you, not...
Pete, I'm being blackmailed.
Blackmail?
Yes.
You mean that's why... Oh, come on, it's crazy.
Right now, I'm a wreck, emotionally. Add to that the pressure of doing this film, and I don't know what'll happen to me. The whole thing could go down the tubes, and I just can't be responsible for causing McBride such a loss, or you.
Wait a minute. Now, I don't know what you're being blackmailed for. I don't want to know. Look, it's my understanding that blackmailers rarely carry out a threat. I would imagine that they're actually very cowardly people.
Yes, unfortunately, I'm a bigger coward. I'm sorry, Tony.
Okay. You got what you came for. If you breathe one word of this, I'll know where the leak came from. You know how many bones in the human back can be broken? I've got a client. He just came to me. He's a Korean. He knows. And he owes me a big favor. Good night, Tony.
Hold the gun.
You get used to it.
What do you care? Maybe the doctors have told me I only have a month to live. Maybe I've got religion. What difference does it make?
First, how can you reasonably expect me to get that much money tonight? And second, after last night, how can you reasonably expect me to believe anything you say?
Now listen, Miss Cameron, we don't usually have these clearance sales. For the measly sum of $5,000, you're getting the following package. All prints, all negatives, and yours truly, off your back for the rest of your life.
To hide some negatives.
Yeah, well, he's a pretty crazy guy. Oh. Isn't he cute?
He kept an extra set of negatives.
We're never going to see one another again. Tell me you're going to miss me.
Just let me have them.
Tell me you're going to miss me. Say it. With meaning.
I'm going to miss you.
All I know is that cloud, whatever it was, hanging over her head, all of a sudden, poof,
Yeah, Maggie?
Mr. Hirsch and the others are waiting for you in screening room 7, Mr. McBride.
Oh, is it time already? Tell them we're on our way.
Got a little surprise for you. We're going to run your test. Yeah, some of the brass are down there waiting to see it. Come on.
Oh, Tony, Mr. Hirsch, Mr. Rabinowitz. You're going to see a lot of them. He's our boy.
Yeah, beautiful.
Sit down here, Tony. I want you to be comfortable. Very important film. Everybody set? Okay, any time. That man in the booth is the one who called you the fireball.
Oh, right. I'll catch him later.
Never forget the little people. Oh, there's some footage on the front end of this reel here. A makeup test we did yesterday. I wouldn't worry about it. Forget the quality. This was shot on infrared film.
I wouldn't come down too heavy on the cameraman, Mac. He does this in his spare time.
Yeah, I know. I used to do a little moonlighting myself. I was once a cop.
Yeah, well, what? I get 2, 3 years? 5 tops, right? I'll be thinking about you two all along. And when I get out, I'm gonna pay you a little visit.
Sure, sure. But your arithmetic's a little wrong there. Captain Rabinowitz will tell you that to take Miss Cameron out of the amphitheater by force. That's assault. Probably a little attempted rape in there. That would be, what, 10, 15? Maybe even 20 years. He's all yours, Eddie. Take him.
Nicely done.
You remember what I told you about the con? You got the feeling?
It's great.
And I'll be sorry to leave all this. I was beginning to like the movie business. Let me ask you something.
What?
You saw the way I took a hold of that role of the producer as an actor, you know? Suppose it's 20 years ago. I'm just starting out. Do you think I could have made it as an actor? What do you think?
What do I think?
Yeah. Lay it on me.
The truth?
The truth.
I think you'd wind up on the cutting room floor.
Well, you said you wanted the truth.
Who in his right mind would ask a con man for the truth?
Being a con man?
Do you ever stop being a cop?
Hey, never particularly fond of cops. I was more comfortable when he was a crook.
Investigator Belasco about to search the premises. Same to you. I came for the jewelry.
Wait a minute. You just don't walk in here like this. I want to see some kind of identification.
Your lady friend back in Philly will give my identification. Meanwhile, she wants her property back.
All right, wait. How do I know that you work for her? How do I know if she's ever going to see this stuff again?
You don't, jerk. Tell you what you do. You keep your mouth shut and go back to living like a rat, because you don't want the cops in on this anymore than she does.
His attack on you, you'd think he was defending a lot more than the junk we found in this room.
Hey, the car's right out front. That's Grand Theft Auto. A guy'll do a lot to beat a rap like that.
I guess you'd know. Well, stick around, Belasco. We have a few questions for you later.
Yeah, anytime. I'm gonna book.
What's the points for the Redskins? What about the Rams?
11 points. Hey, Ivy, this is Malcolm.
Would you tell Mac Lieutenant Griffiths they're the same?
What's the spread look like on Denver? Well, when are you going to know? I'd like to know now.
A lieutenant? Is in the Army, Lieutenant?
No, is in Los Angeles Police Department, Lieutenant.
Never mind, Harry. I don't have to know now. I'll call you back later. Yeah, goodbye.
Hi, Phil. How are you? Nice surprise. How do you like the layout?
Well, not bad for an old cop, Mac. Not bad at all.
Is this a friendly visit, or is my partner in trouble again?
Well, as far as I know, your partner's keeping his nose clean. And I may have a little something to help you pay the overhead.
Oh? Well, come right in.
Oh, for what it's worth, the point spread on Denver's 3.
You could have warned me.
Yeah, well. You live by the sword, you die by the sword.
Hiya, Malcolm. What's the matter with you?
There's a cop in there. I think it's a raid. He says his name is Griffiths, a kind of lieutenant.
A small-time private investigator named Belasco copped the $500,000 in jewels.
Did I hear the mention of a $500,000 in jewels?
You know my partner, Pete, here.
From both sides of the bars. Yeah, you heard right, Pete.
Unless the department has changed since I've been in it. You're keeping a pretty close watch on this fellow, huh?
Yeah, but he can fence those jewels any time unless we can keep a guy with him around the clock. We just don't have the manpower to do it. And that's why I thought of you guys.
Well, I think you made a mistake about us. See, we don't work for the LAPD or any PD. No offense. What's in it for us?
Would a sizable reward make you feel a little better about it?
Now he's interested.
The lady from Philly would like to have her jewels back. And the way we figure it, this private investigator stumbled on the jewels and then stashed them. Now, when a guy's been a detective as long as Belasco, he's too streetwise for us to put one or two tails on. We'd need a dozen men rotating around the clock, and even then he could slip off and fence those jewels. And once he does that, there's no way to link him to the homicide.
But if you nail him with the jewels,
then we got him.
Look, Phil, we'd love to work with you, and we could use the business, but if you can't keep a round-the-clock eye on him with all your manpower, how do you expect the two of us to do it? He could outweigh us right into the poorhouse.
Well, Mac, I was just taking a long shot. You know how many of these we lose by default.
Yeah.
Anyway, listen, I'm glad I finally got a chance to see your digs. It's really
nice,
first
huh?
cabin.
Yeah.
You say this guy was a small-time detective?
Well, I doubt if he ever made over $50 a day in his life.
Yeah, if that much, you know. I gotta tell you, Pete, it's not like in the movies or not like those detective stories there. A real-life investigator, he could spend his whole life tracking down delinquent alimony payments and running for witnesses for petty car accidents.
Then that's it.
What?
That's how we get a guy with $500,000 in jewelry interested in us.
What do you mean, interested in us?
We walk in and give him the detective's case of a lifetime, one he's never had.
What kind of a case?
A glamorous one.
A glamorous?
Don't you guys ever switch on the late show, Casablanca, the Maltese Falcon, the Big Sleep?
Does he get like this very often?
Yeah, very often, but I think maybe this time he's got something.
The key is to find a way to stay close enough to Belasco to prevent him from fencing the jewels.
Ah, an excuse to stay close to him without his realizing what we're up to.
I knew she was trouble the minute she came into my office. She was a porcelain doll, but class. One gander at her legs would make a grown man weep and make a little boy into a grown man. She was no ordinary dame, all right. In 20 years, I hadn't seen anything like her. When she opened her mouth to speak, it was like church bells at an angel's wedding.
Mother and Dad never got along. And, well, Laura was always very sensitive. I guess that's why she ran away from home.
Well, I would really, very sincerely like to help you, but I just don't think I can take on a runaway case at this time.
Well, she shouldn't be too hard to locate. My sister was always the pretty one. What do you normally charge?
$50 a day plus expenses. But I really think the police are your best bet.
I'll pay $200.
$200?
Here. For as much time as you can give me. I'll give you 1 week in advance. That's $1,400. Oh, sorry.
Pardon me.
Yes.
Yeah?
Can you talk?
Not very well, no.
Then just listen. I think I got a buy for those jewels.
How much?
$60,000.
Are you out of your mind or just out of your league? They're worth 20 times that.
But my man, you want it now. How long do you want to sit around for $50 a day when and if you get a case?
Well, it's a very interesting thing. But I happen to be in absolutely no hurry at all. Because I got a case right now. And it may take me some time. And make me quite a bit of money.
Rave on, my man. Rave on.
Yeah, well, I'll do that. And in the meantime, you and me have got a pass, my man. Look, Miss,
Poindexter.
Well, I'll tell you, I'll give you a few days, but that's all.
That's wonderful.
Now, this Belasco, man, he's small potatoes. He's so nervous to unload, he's making up clients to jack me up. Maybe in a day or two. In the meantime, I'm a little bug at the stall. I might snoop around a little, and if I can find out where he's got those jewels stashed, well, we can just eliminate this cat from the deal altogether. Right. You'll be hearing from me.
Miss Poindexter, the ceramic doll, slipped me an address in Santa Monica where I might start looking for her kid sister. Funny. For such a classy dame, I guess I was expecting a Taj Mahal. In this place, it seemed better days.
These in my wallet. Well, you got my gun.
Okay, go for it.
Oh, boy, you sure laid me out. What did you use, cyanide gas?
It wasn't me, sport. Get up. Get up! Put your hands against the wall at 10 and 2.
Well, whoever it was probably lifted the wallet, took my ID and a lot of money.
Yeah, a picture of your dog. It's a real sob story. Make me believe it, will you?
Look, this broad hired me to find his sister. Say, can I drop my hands? A wall won't fall down.
In slow motion, okay? Sit down. This broad. Dark hair, clothes from Bergdorf, built.
Yeah, that sounds like the one. Joan Poindexter.
Joan Poindexter. She's Joan Poindexter like I'm the mayor of Paris. Are you kidding?
Hey, look, I'm too old for this kind of aggravation. Why don't you give me back my gun and I'll exit laugh, and I'm off the case. The money's gone anyway.
How much is she paying you?
A deuce a day.
A deuce a day? Isn't that a little odd? Even at the height of the divorce days, you weren't getting paid more than $50 a day. A deuce a day. She's up to something. Look. It's worth two C's a day to me to keep you into this. Now, I'll give you an advance, $1,400. Now, you just pretend you're still working for her, okay? Just be her friend, and you tell me everything that she tells you. I'm registered at the Larchmont Hotel under the name of Phillips. Have you got that?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, listen, what's this all about? Who are you?
Represent a company that's interested in recovering misplaced property. Listen, you're into something really big, Belasco. Something really big. Probably bigger than anything you've ever had in your whole life. A blonde hair. Poindexter's kid sister was here, all right. She probably took a powder. Listen, when Miss Poindexter came to see you, was there a man with her? A man with a limp?
No.
You sure, huh? Positive? Like this?
I'm sure. There was nobody with it.
Okay, I'm gonna split. Now, when I leave, I want you to count the strands on this rug. When you get to 100, then you can leave, okay? Catch.
Belasco's office?
Yeah, we found a safe, but it was an 8-tumbler. Take a good man a long while to handle that job.
Your tumblers have a weakness, you know.
Yeah?
Yeah, the safe cracker has to use nitro to open them up.
That's right, yeah.
Also, their owners have a little problem, too. There's so many digits to remember. 5 will get you 10. He's written down the combination.
Well, if he has, I couldn't spot it there. Maybe we ought to check out where he lives.
Yeah, right after we pass him over to Malcolm. This had been a day for the Guinness Book of World Records. It was past midnight by the time I got back to my office. Getting up those stairs was like climbing Pike's Peak on roller skates.
But I knew I'd fallen into something big, and I had a rotten feeling it was going to get bigger as soon as I saw the wisp of smoke curling up to my ceiling.
What we have to talk about would better be discussed in darkness. Please, sir, I am unarmed. And I've come to the conclusion that brute force is a facile way of solving problems, Mr. Belasco.
Get what it works for me. I got laid out a few hours ago, Chum. I was one of these Egyptian stink bombs in that room at the time. And that's bad news for you.
Regrettable, but as I told you, I detest violence. And as you can readily see, I'm quite incapable of it. My name is Constantine Proxanos. I intend to be entirely above board with you. And for your compensation, $10,000.
Don't make me laugh.
Laugh? Have you ever heard sort of the Belgian Congo King Leopold IV? Surely the Muscovy Hosa commemorative would strike a responsive chord at you?
The only thing that's going to get struck is the pavement downstairs with you if you don't start talking English.
I'm referring to stamps, sir. 10 of them, to be exact. All very rare, all very valuable. It is those I seek.
Begin at the beginning. Your stamps stolen or what?
Fair question. The chronology begins thus. 1846, the British Crown Colony of Hong Kong. The monsoons, they were kind that year.
This Belasco doesn't exactly live high on the hog, huh?
He doesn't live alone, either. I don't make him.
Hey, that's Charlie Van Skoik. He's our primo fence.
Looks like we've stumbled on the guy Belasco's doing business with on the jewels.
Well, looks like old Charlie is trying to go into business for himself.
Yeah. From the way he's slamming things around in there, it looks like he didn't find anything.
Before he does.
Come on, let's get out of here.
I'll call Allie. Tell her to get back to work on Belasco.
Tonight?
The competition's working at night. You want to be number one, you gotta hustle.
It's a long story, sir, even longer than the other one. I'll explain everything later, but she must not know I am here. Please.
Just a minute, Miss Poindexter. I'll be right there.
Poindexter? She called herself Poindexter? Was there a limping man with us?
What?
A limping man, sir. He walked like this.
The limping man again?
Never mind. Get rid of her. I'll hide in here.
Mr. Belasco, please hurry. He's following me. You've got to hide me. What's in there?
Wait a minute. I don't know what's going on, but whatever it is, I hate it.
Well, I don't blame you. I wasn't entirely honest with you this afternoon. Please,
Hold me just for a second. Then I'll get out of your life. It's him.
Who's that?
He's a terrible man. He's our uncle, Lars and mine. He's out for the inheritance, and believe me, he'll stop at nothing to get it.
Yeah, he's your uncle, and I'm the mayor of Paris.
All right. My name. It really isn't Poindexter.
What a surprise.
It's Sylvia. Sylvia Seaton. I'll tell you everything. But you've got to hide me, just for tonight.
Well...
Oh, please.
Okay, I'll stash it for a while. But just for a while. I got a mobile home. It's only got one bed.
Just as long as it's warm.
Okay, babe. You wait here. I'll be right back.
Stay with her, my friend. Remember, she is the key. Try to get her to talk about Louis Quilby. Can you remember that name, sir? Louis Quilby.
Of course I can remember it, but who is it? Is that the gimpy guy?
Oh, look what you've done, you fool. You've lost her.
Fill in the picture for me.
I wouldn't know where to begin.
Try the beginning.
I was going to report to you as soon as I could.
Oh, really? You mean Connie Praxanos didn't offer you anything?
Nah, I figured him out quick. He's a two-by-four flusher. I thought the guy that really worries me is this guy with a limp. What's his name, Ryan?
You know, sometimes I wonder about you, Lou. One minute you're on the ball, the next minute you're popping questions a dummy wouldn't ask.
What's so dumb about that question?
Do I have a limp? I'm Ryan.
Ryan? You told me your name is Phillips.
I said I registered under the name of Phillips. You gotta think, Lou, you know what I mean? You gotta stay alert, you know?
Oh. Yeah, well, at the risk of popping another dumb question, who is this Egyptian? Who's McBride? Is he the guy with a limp?
Well, that'll be a different story depending upon who you talk to, but I'll fill you in on the straight dope. I'm a claims investigator for New Haven Mutual. I've been on this case for 9 years. You ever hear of a man called Albert Rose, the master thief?
Think so. Is he the guy with a limp?
No. He was a big cracksman in the 50s, took a Brody off the Golden Gate Bridge about 10 years ago. At least, that's what he wants everyone to believe. Pull over right there, will you?
Hey, wait a minute. You didn't tell me what happened.
Use your head, Belasco. Those stamps were stolen 10 years ago. Rose disappeared 10 years ago. 10 years ago, Rose had a daughter 12 years old.
That girl, Nora.
Good. Very, very good, Lou. Very good. Now listen to me. New Haven Mutual is going to pay a $100,000 reward for those stamps. I'm ineligible. But if you could come up with those stamps, maybe we could split the reward and make a deal. Sound good?
Hey, wait a minute. Now let me get this right. $100,000? What are those stamps worth?
Don't think about that one. It's cost 11 men their lives. See ya.
Did you find anything?
Oh, some listening devices here, a couple old racing forms, nothing that looks like a combination. I think Van Skoyt was looking for the same thing we are. Maybe he found it. Maybe it was never... never here.
He's on his way.
Matt, not too long. I really dread getting in the clinches with this guy.
Look, I'll see that you get some extra hazardous duty pay.
I heard your car coming, so I started making some eggs. How do you like them?
Scrambled. Like my brains.
I had to slip out of your office. I saw the Egyptian cigarettes and I heard voices. I was frightened. I hope you don't mind my using your pajamas in your bed. Hope you like them like this. Al always did.
Al? That wouldn't be Albert Rose, the master thief, huh? I got you figured, baby. You were Rose's squeeze.
But I didn't kill him. Ask his daughter when we find her.
His daughter, your sister. Listen, do me a favor. Let's not talk about that anymore for a while, huh? I need some shut-eye.
Yeah, that... Just relax, Boo. Come on. That's it. Come on. That's right. Just let all those little neck muscles relax.
Don't anybody move. You're under arrest. I'm not moving. You show me your warrant.
It's being arranged for kidnapping.
Kidnapping?
Laura Rose was taken from her apartment forcibly this morning, and you've been flashing her pictures all over town.
Now, wait a minute. That's a legitimate job.
Don't smart off. You're in white water here now. But I'll give you a break if you tell me where the girl is.
He's not after Laura. It's the stamps he wants. He blew this case 10 years ago when the Schrader stamp collection was stolen.
Don't pay any attention to her. She's poison.
Jeez! What did you do that for? Are you crazy? This guy's a cop!
Oh.
I could have handled him.
I seriously doubt he's still a cop. I heard he was booted off the force.
Well, he's still clobbering him pretty good. What are we supposed to do now?
Oh, McBride was always a nuisance. Hey, you could douse him with whiskey and send him off Point Doom in his car.
Yeah?
I'll see you tomorrow at your office.
Hey, what's that mean?
It means I gotta buy you.
I'll be waiting, my man. I'll be waiting.
What are we gonna do?
No, not we. You, babe. I don't want to have anything to do with that guy. I'm off the case right now.
Well, what do I do?
You can douse him with whiskey and blow up this trailer for all I care. I am never coming back here. My ship has just... And I am retiring. In short, lady, I am blowing this dump.
Mac, what happened?
Well, like the man said, his ship has come in.
Yes, I'm annoyed, lady, and I know damn well you do have a number where I can reach him, and I want it. Go take a walk till your hat floats.
Lou, I'm sorry to come barging in on you after last night, but I didn't know who else to turn to.
Oh no.
All we've done is run Belasco around in circles. He's really confused. We're no nearer the jewels than we ever were.
Hey, Mac, what we need is a more optimistic outlook. Now, if we can get Allie to get him to open up his safe, we might have a shot.
I'm afraid to step out on the street again with these. I'm afraid McBride will get them. Don't you have anywhere where I can put them where they'd be safe?
Hey, honey, you mind?
Take another day's fee out. With Helen. I'll tell you all about them on the way to the hotel. You did want us to hurry and take a little nap, didn't you?
You crazy broad. Oh, jeez. Belasco.
Ryan, I know you can't talk,
I saw the girl go upstairs, so just listen. We're practically home with $100,000.
Yeah, what do I have to do for my half? Get my head shot off?
You, just get rid of the girl and meet me.
Well, this better be something I can get my teeth into. You've seen the last of me.
I just talked to the president of New Haven Mutual. They practically got the check written.
What is it?
Nothing to do with you, babe. Another big case.
Oh, if you turn on me, I don't know what I'll do. You're all I have now.
Baby, baby, would I let you down?
You're a wonderful man. To the safe is 8 circle numbers on his desk calendar, probably somewhere in January.
My sources tell me that Laura went to Santa Barbara to possibly charter a boat to take the stamps out of Vancouver. We don't know, but what we do know is that she's going to be returning sometime today by train.
Sometime today? Don't you even know what time, Philip?
I wish I knew. I wish I knew. Listen, you keep your eyes open. I've got to make a phone call. And Lou, I'm Ryan.
Yes.
Hey, Mac. I'll have him tied up for hours. Even a cop should be able to open up a safe.
Oh, thanks.
Chasing a limping man.
A limping man? Hey, you made that up, didn't you?
I thought so. I'll call you back.
Heap is parked over there. I think Mac may have gotten his fingers caught in the till.
Tired and disgusted.
Lou, what is it?
You may feel like a winner, kid, but I feel like I've been rode hard and put away wet.
Lou, look. The Schrader collection. This is the most important moment of our lives.
You're just abroad. How do you get these?
Okay. I followed you and Ryan to Union Station. I sat there 15 minutes, and it hit me. Laura was coming in on a train, all right, but not at Union Station at Pasadena. About a month before Al died, he told me that his second wife, Laura's mother, lived in Pasadena. But Laura didn't know that I knew. Lou, it was awful at Pasadena Station. I had to knock her out.
I got an awful headache.
Lou, we've got to move fast. The others are going to find out soon. I've contacted somebody to buy the stamps for $2 million. Darling, I hope I'm not rushing things. But we will be together after this, won't we, Lou?
Oh, you bet, baby. And I won't be in any seedy trailer camp either. This is sure some hinky place to hold a meet.
The location was partly my idea, Mr. Velasco. You see, sir, I am the buyer.
You're the buyer. But you wanted to hire me to find the stamps.
Unfortunately, my plan fails, so I'm compelled to buy. But I mean this sincerely. I wish to congratulate both of you.
I have $1 million in each one of these portmanteaus, but first, I must examine the stamps.
The force, huh? I lost my pension. So I'll take the stamps, I'll take the money.
Unless you want to take a bullet too, Big Mouth. Drop it.
I was hoping you'd follow us, McBride. It's a perfect ending to a perfect day. Remember Tel Aviv? When you slapped me around and you shot my Al? Well, this is for him.
God in heaven, what'd you do that for? What do I care about Al?
Some debts have to be paid off, Lou.
I suggest we hold the post-mortem some other time, some other place, huh? Fleetness of foot is what counts now.
All right, everybody, drop your weapons. Why rush off? I can't remember the last time we were all together like this. Singapore, wasn't it? Poor McBride. Maybe he's happier that it's all over. I know I am. End game, Helen. You can't say we didn't have some good times together. It's funny. You know, I always thought that maybe you and me...
I don't believe you people. You're ruthless.
You're a newcomer to this game, Mr. Velasco. This has been going on for 10 years. Tonight, many old scores were settled. To the victors, sir. Belong the spoils, huh?
Come on, darling. There isn't much time.
What are you doing?
It's our escape to Buenos Aires and happiness.
I can't leave right now, Helen.
What?
I gotta get something. It's very important. I'll explain on the plane.
But Lou, we've got all the money we need.
You just check on a fuel or something. Tell a pilot to wait.
Lou.
Hey. Helen, don't clown around, not with a gun.
Lou, you were going to run to the police and tell them I shot McBride.
Now, in the name of all that's holy, why would I pull a bonehead stunt like that?
I knew when we first met it was going to end like this. I just didn't want to believe it. And I know who you are and what you are. You're a decent, moral man. And for that very reason, I can never trust you. McBride was right. I am poison.
Helen, I am not going to the police. Will you put the gun down? Look, I'm just as dirty as you are. I killed a man, too. I shot him down in cold blood. Look, you can have that on me.
Don't mock me, Lou. Don't lie to me. Murder just isn't in you.
I'm not mocking you, for the love of heaven. I killed a man. A guy I was hired to find. Edward Matlock. I blew him right out of his socks. Look, this is the key to a bank box that has almost $1 million in jewels. That's what I was going for.
Hold it.
Thanks, Pete, Mac. See you guys downtown.
Baby, you were wonderful. Malcolm.
Yeah, Pete. You see that you get some all right?
Oh, my pleasure.
Not you?
Oh, I'll be there later. I've got to get the money back.
You know, I don't mind telling you, I was a little nervous through those last couple of minutes.
Mac, would we use real bullets knowing how you hate guns, huh?
Yeah, but the money here, those hundreds on top, they're real. And we're in a hock right up to our eyeballs till we get this stuff back.
Mac, wait a second.
Huh?
I wouldn't want anything to happen to you while you're carrying our money.
That's very thoughtful of you. Split it, will you?
You know, Mac, this could be the beginning of a beautiful friendship.